This is probably very familiar to you. Those of you who do computer science, it's how you build what's called an algorithm. So you know how to do something. You sit down with a piece of paper and you figure out what exactly you have to do. What decisions do you take? And you build the map of your mind. And then you can feed that map into a machine. And then under those same circumstances, the machine does what you would have done. To someone watching from the outside, it looks
as though that machine is thinking. But it isn't actually thinking. It's only pretending to think. Your mind map is sitting inside it. And you spend, you know, people like you spend 2, 3, 4 years in learning how to build that map and how to load it into a machine. But it still needs a person to do that thinking. What if there are problems where you can't make a mind map like that because you don't know how to solve it? Is it that finally machines wouldn't help you at all? Well, that was the opinion until, I suppose, the 1980s or so, when finally that too changed and a new kind of machine started to come. Machines that can learn. So, if a problem's input is known and output is known and you don't know what happens in between, you can keep telling that machine, well, if you see this, then it means this. If you see that, then it means this, etc. And over a period of time, that machine learns whatever it is that distinguishes those things. The difference between this kind of machine and the previous kind of machine is that that one was pretending to think. This one is doing something, but you don't know what it's doing anymore. Now that, the story gets pretty serious then. As long as you had a machine which could open the back and you knew where all those gears and levers went and where to put the oil and where to tighten the screw, no, that was fine. Here's a machine which is doing something where you don't know what's going on. Is there a machine like that? Should we be worried about a machine like that? But actually there is a machine like that. The only thing is it's not built by humans. That machine's inside your skull, sitting inside you, it's your brain. It too does things. And if somebody asks you, how did you do that? What went through your head? You are often forced to say, I don't know. It just works that way. So, are those two creatures then beginning to approach each other? And that, I think, frightens me. I don't know why it frightens people, but it frightens people. Educators don't exactly know what to do with that fear. Should we scare the students? Should we say, you're never going to get a job? Because, you know, by the time you graduate, there'll be a machine that will do it for you. Or should we say, no, you can build the machines that will take the jobs. That sounds very cruel. What is it that the university should do then? What should they tell you? Well, one thing's for sure. We're going through this age where we're very quickly going to see machines that can think. There'll be no other way to describe what they do except to say they think. There will be a combination of lots of things. You know, all the comp science guys will know many of these neural networks, fast processors, multi-sensory inputs, big data, trainable algorithms, you know, algorithms that change with time. Actually, they are not very much in the future. If you just reach inside your pocket and take out your smartphone, just think of how many of those things are already there inside it. Lots of them. And which is why there are many instances where your smartphone does something and you say, oh, how did you do that? and you think that there is somewhere an engineer who will tell you how it did. But there are now cases where you could go around the whole world asking someone, why did that phone do that? They would say, I don't know. It did it on its own. We are very close, we are that close to the machines that can think. So, should that worry us? Well, another thing that worries, irritates and angers a lot of people is the top line over there.
Machines that are better than us.
But they've been that way for a long time. A lever is better than an arm, a pulley is better than muscle. Starting from there to where we are now. Machines are, in whatever it is that they do, better than us. That's why they're there. So if they're better than us, then they would obviously take over the work that we would do. There's an estimate that I read recently that 50% of all the work in data collection, data processing and repetitive muscle power, 50% can be done entirely by machines. And if you make a list of how many jobs that involves, it would be in millions. It becomes then not so much an engineering decision but a political decision. Should we let them be replaced or should we not? Which is not the kind of decision that we deal with in an academic institution. So how should you think about that? Let's take an example. This is 19th century technology in use, still in use today in Calcutta. Okay, you guys, I don't know how many of you have actually seen one or how many have actually sat in one. Sitting in one is quite an experience, let me tell you. To have a man who's, you know, pulling you along like that. But there are people who actually sit in a rickshaw like that in Calcutta and would say, faster, please, faster. You know, that kind of the guy would run faster. Good or bad? Well, let's see what happens next. Okay, technology moves along. 19th century, early 20th century until now. Calcutta again. The runners are gone. The barefoot rickshaw puller. This is replaced by the cycle rickshaw, which is, you know, sort of pedaled along. And I suppose you feel a lot better now sitting in there. So, well, he's not running after all. He is, you know, pedaling as hard as he can. And you might feel a little more comfortable in saying, hey, the faster piece, you know, that kind of thing. But then what happens? Well, what happens next is, 21st century Calcutta, about a few years ago this happened, you've probably all seen it everywhere now. It looks like a cycle rickshaw, except that the chap doesn't have his feet on the pedals anymore. The rickshaw is just going along. He's put a battery in there. So, now you feel much better. Sitting in one of those, it's silent, the battery is doing all the running. And you can quite happily say, can't we go a little faster? But it doesn't actually stop there. It moves along. The design evolves. They begin to look like this now. Okay? It's not engineering colleges that build these designs. The local artisans who build those designs. A little windshield because, you know, the driver says, it's fine, I don't have to pedal anymore, but, you know, in the rain I get wet or whatever, so it builds a little. And it changes to this. This is in Prague. So this is about the best cycle rickshaw that you can get anywhere. Okay, you have this nice guy, sits in there, usually overcharges you a lot. You sit in the back, you're no longer sorry for him. You're quite annoyed with him for overcharging you. And he takes you as fast as you want to go. He's got marvelous batteries and everything. But the story doesn't end over there either. The next one. This is from one of the IITs. It looks a bit like that Prague rickshaw. Except that there's one difference. If you look carefully, there's no driver. You know? There's just the two riders. and there is no drive, but the thing is driving itself. What does it mean? It means that the algorithms in the driver's head and the driver's ability to think are now inside the processor. The multi-sensory inputs that the driver was processing is now inside the vehicle. It's out there. But just imagine, imagine if those auto rickshaws that you take around here, imagine if the driver didn't have to use his brain, wouldn't that be a great improvement? Here are some of the estimates of what's going to happen. Machines that are almost better than us, more than 5% of all occupation can be nearly done, 90 to 100% by machine, all meaning my occupation, teacher included. So, now what do we do? This is serious stuff. What kind of world is that?
So what happens to education? What should we teach people? Should we teach people skills?
Knowing that in 15 years time, a machine will acquire those skills and replace them. What point does that make? You might say, well, it depends on what kind of skills. So let's not teach those typically manual kind of skills. Let's look at the fine upper end of skills. So, what should we educate children about then? Well, certainly we can agree on one thing, that they need a new education. An education which doesn't teach them about the past. You know, so far, everything you've learned, everything is about the past. You know, whether it is Maxwell's equations or whether it is whatever political theory, it's about something that was done in the past, and then it's taught to you in the hope that it will help you to go into the future. But you know that given the current rate of change, it no longer works that way. If you know, you know, all about building scaffolding for a builder to do brickwork, and you think that 5 years later that skill is going to be useful, there's no guarantee. There's no guarantee there will be any builder at that time. So then what should the children learn? The children should learn how to quickly adapt to what's next. How do you know what's next? Hence, this topic is important. The future of learning itself. We all pride ourselves by saying, if you learn, then you know. And what this is saying, this logic that I was telling you so far, is saying that it's not very important to know. If they let you use your smartphone, you don't need to know. I know you're looking even more serious, but the thing is that that's how it is. In England, I once asked undergraduate course people, what would happen if we allowed you to use your smartphones during your exam? They said, we would feel very happy. So I said, why? And they said, because, this is something quite interesting, they said, because everybody will not score the same marks, but it would just be a lot less stressful because we wouldn't have to keep remembering stuff which is inside the phone. So, that's a totally different kind of future, isn't it? I started setting up these places called schools in the cloud. And I did 7 experimental ones with the prize money that I got. 5 in India, 2 in England. Where the idea is that the children or the students, instead of being taught, are simply asked a question. So instead of saying, how do you bake a cake? Or instead of saying, let me show you how to bake a cake, you would say, how do you bake a cake? And they would come back to you. And you can do this with almost any subject. You can do it with mathematics, you can do it with physics, you can do it with anything that you want. just a question. And then if you needed an expert, if you desperately need a human, well, you can get one, you know. You don't have to look around your village for one. You can get one from anywhere in the world using Skype or whatever it is, as long as you have an infrastructure, which I built actually. I built an infrastructure called the Granny Cloud. It's full of retired teachers. So if you're really, really stuck, or if you're, you know, kind of fed up of quizzing your phone all the time, you can actually speak to a human being. We need a transition. Other occupations, other skills, higher order abilities, stuff that we can't predict. So how do you teach something that's going to happen which you cannot predict? You can't, obviously. What you can teach is, how do you tackle it if a paradigm shifts? So in the England schools, I started asking the children, and these were primary school children, I started asking the children questions to which their teachers didn't know the answers. For example, you'd say, does a red shirt go well with a black pair of trousers? And everybody says, yeah, it does. I said, is it better than, you know, for example, a bright purple shirt with a red pair of trousers? And they'll say, oh, that's terrible. So I said, so why is it that red goes with black? And then I would turn to the teacher, and the teacher would have no idea. And then I would send them off, and I would say, well, there's the internet. Half an hour later, you'll get back an answer. It'll probably be out of anthropology from 9-year-olds, and it'll explain why red goes with black. It's an education that couldn't have existed until now, but we need it now. So we need to change education from just in case. That's the stuff that we teach. If we look at all the things that you do in 3 years, so why did you teach me all this? And I as a teacher will say, you know, just in case you ever need it. We need to shift from just in case to just in time. Because if it is just in case, I mean, for example, everyone in this room was taught how to solve a quadratic equation, I'm sure. And I can say for myself, the last time I solved a quadratic equation was in the test that was testing if I knew how to do it. Never ever had to solve one after that. And to the generation that's growing up today, if you ask them, shall I teach you how to solve a quadratic equation? They'll say, no, 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 don't teach me that. And you'd say, well, why not? What will you do if you had to solve a quadratic equation? And he'll kind of look at you and say, I'll say, Alexa. Okay. This is, on the left is the good old examination, okay, just in case examination. Which year did Napoleon lose the war? Now you can't say, why are you asking me that? Okay, even more, you cannot say, why are you asking me that and why have you taken away my phone? You can't ask any of those in the just in case kind of exam. So I'm suggesting that we move to the just in time. I'll ask you stuff that you haven't been taught, but I'll give you your phones back. Which kind of exam would you like? Qualifications, you know, we're all in that game. You're going to get your degree, you're going to get a certificate or whatever. Just in case. Just in case somebody asks, so how do I know that you're good at this? I say, sir, here is my bachelor's degree. Well, suppose your bachelor's degree is in computer science. All about computer science, and one day you get this call, you're an engineer, you're a computer engineer. Well, I've got a problem, sir. What's the problem? You see, my dog has just encountered a robot dog on the road, and there's going to be mayhem. What would you suggest? None of your computer science is going to help you at that point. Okay? You figure out how you solve that problem. That's the problem on the right-hand side. It actually happened. Well, this quotation from Sir John Daniel is a well-known educator. It basically says that you can't, you know, as students you always have to be skeptical and ask more questions. As teachers you have to throw the questions at your students. It's the question that's going to drive the whole system. Why? Because the phone has all the answers. The internet has all the answers. It doesn't have the questions. The questions have to come from the teacher. The better you are at making up the question, the better the education system will be. So what happens to universities? You know, there's something very interesting about the future. You can't predict it. Everybody knows that. You can't predict the future. We are supposed to be preparing you for your future. But at the same time, I'm saying as a professor, I can't predict the future. But there is something else that you can do with the future. You can create it. Right? So I think universities should go back to where they started from a long time ago. And what they have always done the best is not predict the future, not teach you about the past, but help you to create the future. Thanks.